Hello, everybody. It's a big number. Thanks for coming. I want to talk about a project that I've done with a colleague of mine, Apostolis Parachutis, and the title is Evaluation of Interior Noise Based on Loads from a Multibody Simulation. Okay, what is this about? Everybody knows, I guess, that NVH performance is an important criteria for car development. People who are dealing with NVH might know that most of the NVH analysis types are linear. Is this the problem? It might be, because look, in a chassis, in a full vehicle, there are parts that are clearly nonlinear. All the mounts between the chassis and the body, the engine mounts, are nonlinear. So what can we do about this? Is there a way out? I mean, maybe not just one, but we thought of using multibody dynamics, because this is a method which can capture nonlinearities easily. And this is why we try to put together within the BETA suite a process which combines multibody dynamics with NVH calculations. And the process looks in a workflow like this. After some general preparation work, we divide the parts into the flexible parts, which is in our case the trim body, which goes in the linear procedure and the linear workstream, and the rest of the car are the rigid components for the multibody dynamics. So these two steps can actually start in parallel. And one output of step number two are the modes for the trim body that we need for the NVH calculation, as well as the fluid structure interaction. And as well, we calculate the MNF file for the trim body, which is again, which contains the flexible modes, but for a multibody dynamic simulation. Having this, we can perform step number three. We get the loads out of it for a certain driving maneuver. And then we can take the loads from the nonlinear multibody dynamics, take the modes from the linear calculation of the trim body, put it together and do post-processing in Meta. So the next 20 slides are just a more detailed description of what I've told you in this slide. We start in the general preparation with the cavity, of course, because we want to do acoustic with the trim body or with the full vehicle. And we just have to take in mind that the trim body, we need it as a complete Nusslon model or a Pilisys model with all connections, trim masses, properties, everything has to be there. And the other parts, the subframe, powerframe, which are just rigid bodies in the multi-body simulation, we just need the masses and the inertia. So either we get a cat or an image or just numbers, it doesn't matter. And in the next step, we have to think of where do we divide the two models, and we have to define these interface points, because the interface points, they have to be in both models. In the trim body, these are the points where the loads are applied, where the responses are calculated, and in the in this part in the rigid bodies, and we need this point because we need the forces there. And then we can go into the different steps, the linear step, NVH, and the multibody dynamics. What do we do in the NVH part? So first of all, we have to take the model and we have to create a display model. Okay? A display model is, I don't know if you can see it, this mesh is much coarser than this mesh. And the idea is you do the calculation on the fine mesh, and just for a couple of output nodes, which are in this model, you get the results. That makes everything much smaller, the model and also the result files, because we need the result files for all the modes. The display model is a key enabler to have manageable file size of the model base. So we do this in NVH console in this environment, because that's pretty easy to load a model and create a display model. We have the tools in Anta anyway, but NVH console makes it even easier. The next step what we have to do is we have to take care of the structure, of the coupling between structure and cavity, because we don't have the full FE anymore, we don't have all the grids, so we have to do something This is good, we calculate the reduced fluid structure coupling matrix. Again, NVH console does the job for you, so it's pretty easy. And NVH console also calculates or outputs all the NASTA decks that you need in order to run the model analysis. And we run the model analysis with epilysis. And actually here the key enabler is that we have RMLS in epilysis, because if you do for a trim body, if you want to calculate the modes up to 250 Hz in this case, or 300, 400 Hz, and without MLS you wait for days for the results, with MLS you just have an hour or two. So this is so we have it in MLS, we have MLS in epilysis, so we can use it. The next step is an interesting step, because we have now the modes for the trim body, and we need to know for the multi-body dynamics where are the global guides, not the global modes. In order to check that, I applied some load cases. If this is the car, the front part and the rear part, and you have an attachment point at the rear and at the left hand side, you excite it in y direction in order to excite the lateral modes. Yeah? You excite it but this is easier for us, the vertical modes, you just excite it in z direction, and the torsional modes is this combination with different presigns. You need load cases. Again, I defined them because it's pretty easy in NVH console. And also NVH console runs the job in order to get the results for these load cases. And this is the torsional excitation. And you can see clearly here, there are a few distinguished sharp global modes. And afterwards, after 50, 60 Hertz, there's nothing going on. So you know where the loads are, where the frequencies are. And with another tool within NVH console, I won't go into details now, this is the modal participation analysis, which tells you in this case, look, there was a peak at 22 Hertz, and which modes are responsible for this, and here are here's the response classified by modes. And there's just one guy, of course, there's just one guy in this case, it's global mode, and you know the mode number. So with a few clicks and the tools that are available, you know the frequencies, you know the modes. We're actually done with the stuff that we need for NVH, but we also have to calculate the MNF file, which goes into the multi-body dynamics. Okay? And here, again, we use the display model. Because the MNF file without the display model is pretty huge. We had a customer who requested that, and we thought, yeah, the idea is great. And we figured out that other solvers can't deal with a display model when you want to calculate MNF. So you end up with 7 gigabytes. So we said, this is actually quite easy. We have epilysis we implement to calculate MNF for a display model. So we can reduce the file size. This is here to about 90%, but if you have a smaller mesh, the gain is even much bigger. And here we take for the MNF file the cutoff frequency of 50 Hertz, because that was the outcome of our global modes investigation, where we learned, okay, the global modes are below 50 Hertz, and over 50 Hertz there's nothing, and we hope that's enough, yeah, for the multi-body dynamics. Okay, again, key enabler is the display model, and of course that epilysis can use it for MNF file calculation. Coming to kinetics, in ANSA kinetics we do the multi-body dynamic calculation. We have to define the bodies, the trim body and the other parts as bodies, that's the word, and either they are flexible, in our case just the trim body, or they are rigid, or the other parts are rigid. And we have to define now how they are connected, yeah, with joints and bushings. And on top we need what is the road and what are the tires. So we can build roads in ANSA kinetics and create tires. I will show that to you in a minute. First of all, this is a major or more very important curve. It's a nonlinear curve. This is going into the system. Okay, this is the force deflection curve for the subframe. And it's maybe important to mention that we are very flexible. Flexible is, I think, my favorite word here. We are very flexible in order to get these curves into kinetics. So we can use tables, user expressions, or even Python scripts. So then we can do very fancy stuff.
And as I said, we use the display model, but of course we have variants. We also use a rigid body for the trim body, and we also have an MMF file with the full model in order to compare later on. Yeah. So not very much about the tires. We have Pacheca, we have F-tire in Multibody. In Ansa Kinetics, we used just F-tire for the results that I'm showing to you in a minute. We have a road builder where you can define these roads. So either you have a nice sine road, and we designed it like that, that we have a excitation at the car of 26 hertz. And so we can compare this sine road with the Belgian rock road, which is a cobblestone road, which is more random-like, the excitation. Yeah. And this is actually, I think it's quite cool, but you have to decide. This is the output out of Ansa Kinetics. And now we take the output files, it could be also an output from Adams, put it into MetaPost, and MetaPost is able to visualize these multi-body dynamic results, and also can display the flexible motions of the car. And these arrows are the forces, or the interface forces, so we can see everything that we want. Here we have the rendering stuff, and so it all looks, I think, quite nice. But this is just an intermediate step, but I wanted to show you such an animation because we can do it. So we did different types for the trim body, flex body, rigid body, with different tires. Yeah, we played around with it. I will just show you one tire, and we have two roads. We always calculate the animation for 1 second in 1,000 steps. So the step size was 1 millisecond. And yeah, so then we have done, we have the animation, and the next step, what we have to do is we have to collect the forces. I mean, we have in kinetics, there are results for all the interface points. Yeah, we can take the forces, and this we had to do. This is the first thing where we had to do something with scripting. We had to collect all the force curves and put them together in order to get an Astron mode case. And here, just for one, for the front top mount, are the three directions, and this is the 26 hertz road. This is why we see a frequency of 26 hertz in this curve. We wanted to do later on not just transient response, also in the frequency regime responses, so we have to do an FT of all this stuff. We did it all with scripting because it was easier for us at this point in time. Interesting result from my point of view is here. So this was the 26 hertz road, and we have a peak at 26 hertz in the forces, of course. But we also have the high harmonics here, which is kind of proof that, look, if you excite a system with a harmonic 26 hertz signal and you get out the high harmonics, if the system is harmonic, if the input is harmonic, probably this is a result of the nonlinearity. So now we have everything. We have modes from the first calculation, we have forces from the second calculation, and we go to MetaPost. In MetaPost, we have the tool which is called Modal Response Tool. And usually I wouldn't show any screenshots of tools, but in this case I'm doing this because I wanted to show you how easy the next step is now that I'm going to do. Look, I have to load in the first step the modal results from the MDH calculation. In the second step, I load the fluid structure interaction. The third thing is I load the load case. So three files, I load them. And then I set up the frequency ranges that I want to, where I want to have results. I set up a node where I want to, the response DOF, and what I want to calculate, pressure or displacements or whatever. So this is actually totally simple. Everybody can learn that in 5 minutes. And the beauty of it, you press button and within a few seconds you have a result. Yeah? And for curves, also for 3D results. So that's very cool, especially if you want to, like me, I was playing around with different Fourier transforms and stuff like that. So you have to change the load case all the time. And just change the load case, press calculate, and you have the next curve. You don't have to wait at all. You can't go for coffee or anything. You have to work constantly. So this is actually pretty simple. So I think it's highly efficient and user-friendly, this tool. There's one but that I have to say. There's one but. At the moment, we can't calculate transient pressure results. It's not that we don't know how to do it. It's just nobody has asked us before to do it. There was no request. And we all thought, oh, we have it. And then I started the project, and 2 weeks before I had to finish it, I thought, oh my God, it's not working. So I didn't get it in the last 2 weeks from our programmers. So I had to go to Nastron and do Nastron run for the transient pressure curves. Yeah, all the others coming out of this tool. Now I come to the results, which are, so I was new on this field. I was doing NVH before. I didn't have any contact with multi-body dynamics, and this stuff was new for me. So quite interesting playground. Interesting thing here is, you see, look, this is the pressure at the microphone position in the car, transient, so in time regime and frequency regime. And when I show you different curves, the thing that I'm changing is always the load case. Yeah? The system, the trim body is always the same. So the load case here, the difference in the load case is, once I use the full MNF with the detailed model and the MNF with the display model. And the curves are line on line. That shows that this display model approach is working. I mean, it should work, theoretically, but if you implement stuff, things can go wrong. You know? So people want to see that it's really working and it's working. The second interesting result is this one. Here, for the 26 Hertz road, I have the transient and the frequency responses. For the pressure, this is the driver's ear and its seat attachment point. And as you can see, and what do I compare in this case? I compare taking a flex body in the multi-body simulation compared with the rigid body of the trim body in the multi-body simulation. Okay? And you see, if you take a rigid body, the response is much higher. It's much higher. And there are some peaks which are much more pronounced. This is the general trend. I changed the slide a little bit. Now I have here the pressure for the 26 Hertz road and here the pressure for the Belgian block road. The Belgian block road doesn't have any specific input frequency, which makes it a little bit easier. You see here the two peaks, which are, yeah, they are much higher in the, for the rigid body than for the flex body. And if you check where are the frequencies, these are the trim body eigenmodes, the global eigenmodes. So what is happening actually is, if the system is excited and the body is rigid, then there are big forces, higher forces in the interface point, in the interface bushings. If the body likes to move there because it has an eigenfrequency, then everything is softer, forces are smaller. And when you apply these forces later on this system again, and the trim body in the NVH calculation has always a resonance there, then you see the difference. You see, this is the, I found quite interesting explanation. The 26 Hertz rules also has some interesting features. Again, we have 26 Hertz and we have the higher harmonics. So obviously the trim body is linear, so it telephones the input through the system, and you see the higher harmonics also in the output. So these two results are major, or the major outcome, because it tells you you should go for flex bodies when you do something like this, and you can do it because you can use the display model. The next slides, I want to show you what else you can do with our modal model, our modal response tool, in Meta. Of course, you can do this fancy 3D stuff. Yeah? Transient structural response, frequency structural response, acoustic frequency response, acoustic grid point participation. I won't tell in detail what it is, but you can do all these nice pictures. And these three guys, you have to wait for them again 3 or 4 seconds. I mean, it also depends on the workstation, but it's quick. This takes a little bit longer because this is an animation over the whole time, and I think it was 300 frames or something that I had to build. I don't know how long it took, because then I really went for a coffee. And I wanted to measure it, but it was the day before the conference, so I let it. Anyway, so this is what we can do in 3D. And here I have to tell you again the stuff about modal participation, because as I said, again, it's in the modal response tool, you press another button and you get this. And what does it tell you, how does it help you? Here you have the response for a road, and then you ask for a certain frequency, this is marked here, 22 Hertz, which modes contribute most, okay? And for these modes, for these top contributors, you get a curve, you get the polar plot, the complex addition summation, and you get then here the percentage values. And this is actually the Belgian block road, and at the first peak, and I can see clearly now, this peak is dominated by mode number 19, because I had investigated what mode number or where the global modes are. I know that mode number 19 is a global mode. So the explanation I gave you a few minutes ago is correct. It is a global mode that makes the high resonance in the curve. Okay, and also if you do, we can do fluid modal participation. Again, this can tell you something. Here I looked at the 50 Hertz peak for this 26 Hertz road. And I said to you, this is a high harmonic. You can say a high harmonic, you can tell me things. This is the first fluid mode, which is also at 50 Hertz. And when you look in this graph, you see the first fluid mode is here, 22 Hertz. This is the rigid body mode of the cavity. So it's not the cavity mode, yeah? It's not the explanation. So this is, I think, gives you an easy insight in what is going on. We have another tool which is really, I think I was working with it, I was quite impressed. It's the transfer path analysis. It's a different window, but you have to do more or less the same steps. And then you ask for TPA, transfer path analysis. So remember, I just put in the modes and the loads, and I have to press five buttons and I get a TPA. Yeah? You don't have to do anything. And then you get again such a window here, and TPA, I have to say, what do I want to investigate? It's now not which mode is doing the response, but which transfer path, which interface point is responsible for the response. Where is the energy going through? And then I get something like this. I have now different paths here. I have here the transfer fractions, the percentages, the polar plot. And on top, I have for the top contributors now, what's the point mobility? What is the transfer function? What is the connection force? I don't know, can you see? Yeah, look, if you go back and forth, different guys are highlighted here. Now I just highlight this one, the brown one. And the brown one has a high, has peaks in the forces, and it's totally flat here. That means this path is active because the forces are high. If I switch, where was it? This violet guy here, the forces are flat, but the transfer functions are high. So this path is active because the system responds on this frequency. And this is always the case. If you do a transfer path analysis with this tool, you can distinguish, I have a problem there because of this and this path, and this and this path is a problem because A, the force is too high, B, because the system has a problem there, or you have a mixture. But sometimes you can really gain some insight there. So I just wanted to show you that you can, with the tools that we have in MATA, you can analyze such a system very easily and get some deep understanding, I think. This is actually what I wanted to show you. To summarize, I mean, I think I have shown you a very seamless process completely inside the BETA suite with Kinetics, Apilisys, ANSA, MetaPost, where we can do this combination of MB, multi-body dynamics, and MBH on the other side. I showed you that the flex bodies, or the rigid body, the flex bodies have an advantage, probably. They're probably, I mean, I can't prove it, I can't compare to anything, but the explanation and what I've seen tells me you should go for a flex body, because the results are different, yeah, it has a big impact, and you can go and use the flex body because you can use the display model approach. And the meta tools, which are not brand new, which are, we are still working on them, but they have been there for quite some while, they are really effective in analyzing such a system. Of course, we have found a few things that could be better, in the process. We did it for the first time. And in unlike Kinetics, we think, of course, nobody wants to script later on in order to get an FFT and to get a load case. We need a button, a button transient load case and a button frequency load case with this and these settings for the FFT. And in Meta, of course, we need acoustic transient response as soon as possible. And I have to always convince my my colleagues to do that who are doing this. And modal participation for transient response would also be very interesting. You know, if you see for time curve, which are the modes that are actually producing a peak in the time machine. And of course, if somebody is interested in this process and is coming to us to BETA and says, I like that and I want these features, it will speed up the process. a quick word. You can, of course, play around with this process. You can have more flex bodies in multi-body dynamics, not just one, it's not a problem. You can also, if you want, you can cut the trim body into pieces and have subcomponents and use all the technology that we have in NVH console in order to do this. You know, it's not a big deal. And we are actually in Ansa Meta where everything can be automated with session files, Python scripts, and so on. So the whole process is probably highly, you can automate more or less everything. I think nearly everything, and you can run optimization loops if you want. This is makes it very easy. Yeah, that's it.